So good. Beautiful weekend. I had a great week. We painted the back wall. Doesn't it look nice? All cleaned up. Somebody had to go all the way up there and paint the roof. And I want to tell you, it wasn't me. Actually, Sam painted everything. He did a great job. We want to thank Sam for being brave. The church has a lift, but how many of you know, I don't care. Yeah, that's high. And that lift is like, just goes straight up and straight down. It's crazy. But every time you're like doing something, it's moving like this much. It's like all over the place. But yeah, we had to paint the speakers and paint everything, and we wrapped those, and a bunch of people helped, and it was good. We're not quite done yet, but it's on its way. Looks cleaned up, and it's good. The next thing is the seats. That'd be the only thing. We've done everything in the sanctuary, and we're kind of moving through the building, and the seats are about 35 years old, so that some seats are good, and others it's like you sit and you're hitting rock bottom. So I want to tell you that, you know, the seats are a little bit more expensive than paint, so that would be a different project, but it's good. God's good. Actually, we talked about it at the beginning of the year, but we are moving, did the nursery rooms. If you want to peek in there, the nursery looks so good. Both nursery rooms got done, and it just looks awesome. And we've had, the nursery team has been down there just getting everything. Everything's new in there, new linoleum. Actually, it's like, I don't know what it is, wood floor type stuff, and carpet got laid, and yeah, it looks really great down there. And the kids' church is next, and we have the hallway. We're doing the hallway and new carpet down that. And it's as long as a football field. It's 93 feet long, and it's a wide hallway, and it's cool. So we're excited about that, and you'll be seeing that in the next few weeks. I don't know how long, but in the next bit, we'll be tearing out the carpet and trim and redoing that, and we got some cool ideas, so that will be good, and we're excited. You got your Bibles this morning? We're going to be in a couple different ones. We're just going to start in Psalms, so you can open up right in the middle, and we're actually in the longest chapter in the Bible, Psalms 119, and we'll also, you can put a marker there, and we'll be in Luke chapter 11. How many of you know in this world we have craziness? We have people that are hungry for fellowship. We have people that are hungry to get out. I was watching the news this morning while I was eating my cereal, and the news was saying that the Seattle waterfront opened up. And how many of you know it never closed really, because it's a waterfront, so you could swim to the Seattle waterfront. If everything was closed, you could still make it there, but people were excited to be there. Businesses are excited. Last year, they lost $700 million in just the waterfront from business and vacations and people visiting. That's a lot of moolah to, a lot of people buying clam chowder. When I think of the waterfront in Seattle, I think of Ivor's clam chowder and going and seeing the curiosity shop and seeing the mummy with the bullet in its side and all those things that we go and do. In these last few years, we've seen, you know, the shutdown, we've seen the virus, we've seen all this craziness, but people are hungry to go out. People are hungry to go and have fellowship. And my concern with those that follow Jesus is that we have fellowship with the right thing. We need to, as believers, we need to have fellowship with Jesus. Because often we get in the habits of the world and we accept these things in our life as though they are what we do. And I want to tell you, that's not what believers do, followers do. Now, I'm all for going and going and doing things. I like to go and get out, and I want to go to the waterfront, and I want a vacation. I want to do these things. But when entertainment and when things take the place of God in your life, it's going to lead you down the wrong path every time. So we want to be careful in setting up our time and setting up our days to where everything is being replaced with other things. So today we're going to be talking about being led by the lamp, being led by the Word of God. And we're going to see here in Psalms 119, 105, it says, "Your word is a lamp to guide my feet and a light for my path." See, God's word should be that lamp that in the midst of your darkness, in the midst of your trials, in the midst of your days, it's the light that lights your feet on the path of where you're going. And if that path isn't following him, you're following somewhere. That path is leading you somewhere. See, I think for some people, you get in discussions and you're not able to defend where you're going. You're not able to talk about the things in your life and the path that's leading you to God. I believe that some people's path is leading you to other things. You're on a search for happiness. You're on a search for what you think is right. You're on the search for the truth. We hear that. We're on the search for the truth. But how many know that if the truth is not in Jesus, your truth is not truth? There's only one truth. And that path is leading you to that truth. And I think that Jesus is always calling out from those dark places. And when things open up and when the lights come back on and everything starts happening, make sure that your path is still heading in the right direction. How many of you have ever woke up and headed across a dark house and you stubbed your toe? Just love that. My wife found the only nail somehow is in the floor this morning, and she stubbed it and it stopped her, but it actually took her sock right off her foot. And she had her coffee in her hand. She spilled some coffee, but she was like, and it took her sock and she fell. And I'm kind of like looking at her like, "What do you want? I don't know what you're doing." So she goes and feels on the floor, and there was a nail, the little head of a nail. It's like, man, what a morning to stub your toe, busy rolling to church, and you find the only head of a nail instead of your toe. I think that for those mornings that I've, hit my pinky toe, that is the worst pain ever. I'd rather be punched in the face than to have that pinky toe be damaged in the dark. But it's when we don't have the light, we don't have the lamp, we don't have that light at our feet, at our path, that we get off. And how many know that you can get off just like a little bit, but over a long distance, you could be way off the path. You could be way away from where you're heading. How many know that we are living in a dark world? We're living in a place where most voices are not voices of positive and light and God words. We're stumbling around spiritually because we aren't using our word to light our path. You might be using knowledge. You might be using, the popular opinion. You might be, for young people, using TikTok to light your path. And the knowledge that they grab from TikTok and Instagram and social media, it lights their path. They get great amount of knowledge from people, influencers, that are lighting their path. And they spend hours and hours and hours getting lit in a direction that is leading them not down the path that leads to God. So first we're going to talk about God's word is a light and a lamp to guide our feet. Watch how many times that Luke chapter 11, verses 33 through 36 says the word lamp and light. No one lights up a lamp and then hides it or puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where its light can be seen by all who enter the house. Your eye is a lamp that provides light for your body. When your eye is good, your whole body is filled with light. But when it's bad, your body is filled with darkness. Make sure the light you think you have is not actually darkness. If you are filled with light with no dark corners, then your whole life will be radiant, as though a floodlight were filling you with light. See, how many times is it talking about those lamps in your life? How many times is the Word of God filling up those dark corners in your life? I think for some, man, we light up maybe some of the things in our life, but we still have habits and things and ideas in dark corners, hurts in dark corners that we need to let the light come in and open up our life enough to have God come in. But it's through God's word. See, God wrote the whole book. God wrote the Bible. There might have been 40 authors and 40 people who wrote the Bible, but there was only one author. And if God had one responsibility, how many of you know he could probably pull off writing one book? He didn't write a bunch of books. He wrote one. And I believe the creator of the universe, the creator of everything, man, could probably figure out how to pull off one book. So some people just can't wrap their heads around, you know, man, did God write the Bible? And I think he did. I think he figured it out, how to write one book. But we have to understand that this book, man, it lights up dark places. It lights up those places in our life that truly need to be lit up and illuminated, it says. See, if you allow the Word of God to shine in you, it will fill you with light. Have you ever just seen somebody and they just look dark? Just like, you know, they could be just, it's just their kind of, they call it the aura. It's just dark. Just some people, it's like you interact with them and it's just like, man, it's just like, there's something about you. You know, they could be wearing a clown outfit, or they can be wearing bright colors, but they're just dark. It's just they come across. But then you meet other people, and it's like, man, they're just like full of life and full of joy, and it's like, what is inside of you? And often, you know, you can just tell people that are Christian, tell people that have Jesus living on the inside. I think I told this story, but we were in Brennan? Somewhere up north, and everyone in the city that I ran into was believers. There was just a lot of people. There's just on the main strip, there was 30 churches within this block, and everywhere was a lot of churches. And there was, you know, the first Netherland church of something, 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 and then in the parking lot, there must have been a church split. There was right across the parking lot, 100 feet away, was the second church of Netherland, you know, some Christian church. And I was like, well, there you go. You know, they just disagree, and they didn't like that worship set. So they were like, we got to build a different church. And now they're the second church of the Netherlands and something like that. But in this stretch, it was Linden. I don't know what I was thinking. My brain wasn't working. But in Linden, they don't have bars within city limits. You can't have alcohol in there. I thought, wow, that's crazy. But it seemed like everyone went to church. Everyone I had talked to, they were like, oh, yeah. You know, and I'd hear, you know, Christian music playing. And I'd be like, oh, you got Christian owners. And they, oh, yeah, I'll go to the same church. And I was like, wow, that's cool. And then I was like, what church was that? And they go, Church on the Rock or something like that. And I was like, oh, that's cool. And then I'm sitting in the hot tub, and I'm talking to this guy. And I was like, oh, yeah. He goes, what do you do? And I'm a pastor in Port Orchard. Oh, that's great. I go to church, too. And I go, let me guess. You go to Church on the Rock. How did you know? He goes, all these old people in the pool, they all go to the church with me. I'm like, well, that's cool. I think the entire town goes to that church. He goes, they do. Everyone goes to the church. And but it was life. It's just that interaction where it's like, you just know. You assume. The lady at the gas station. We were looking for ice cream. We were looking for our licorice ice cream. And she goes, no, you have to go to this other store. And I was like, you go to church? And she goes, yeah, I go to Christ on the Rock. I was like, oh, that's awesome. I was just joking at that point. But everyone went to, I think it was like part of the resume of working in the town or living there. Yeah. But there's a light that we see. There's just a light and a love that people have towards other people. Just an engagement that people have. You could see it in their eyes. You could see it of how they talk. Think about this. Think about how much darkness that we have every day. How much negativity. How much bad things are happening in our world. There was 80 people in SeaTac this morning that they were in an apartment fire. And they said that the Red Cross had to find 80 people a new place to live. How many know those are dark days for those people? They lost everything in their apartment, and now they have to find a new place to live. That's a bad week. That's a bad day. You know, to find a new place, and you know, there's not a lot of places to live out there, and now they have to go and find new things, and it's negative. There's negative things happening around us. You know, and often we're in these places where, man, in your work, there might be negativity. There might be a dark place that you work. You need to be that light. But you'll never shine unless you have the lamp inside of you, unless you have God's light shining. I was talking to this man about his life in drugs. And he had been addicted for a long time, and he was telling me about everything that he had done and everything he had seen. He was just telling me these stories of all these things, and he said that I couldn't even. He kept saying, "You couldn't even believe what I did. You couldn't believe what I saw. You wouldn't understand." And at the end of it, I looked at him and I told him that I don't have to see what you've seen to know that it was dark. I don't need to go through your experience. And matter of fact, I don't want to go through your experience to know how dark it was, but I want to let you know that there's a light that you can let into those dark places. And see, for this individual, he had slowly let that light in, and it started to change, started to take out some of that hurt, started to roll, and he started to wrestle with some light ideas, some lamp ideas. See, it doesn't matter if it's drugs or alcohol or sexual immorality for you. That light takes care of the darkness. How many times has light failed you? If the light actually turns on in the darkness, how many times, 10 out of 10, that light will enter that darkness and it will take care of the darkness? This room is very dark at night. You turn off the lights, but I tell you what, you light one match. You don't light a match in here. If you turn on one cell phone, you just have a little bit of light in this room and it fills up the entire room with light. Just a little bit of light will come in and fill those dark spaces every time. It takes care of the darkness. You may be sitting here today and you have something too. You have something in your life It might not be, you know, a big deal, but it's a big deal to you. And it's darkness to you. And God's word will take care of that darkness in your life. But if you take it and you take that word and you allow God's word to come into your life and you read it and you study it and you meditate on it, you memorize it, it will overcome the darkness. Just like turning on the light, it will, man, it will shine. You'll see your feet again. Some people haven't seen their feet. Like, man, those are nice shoes. I haven't seen that. When I was really big, I couldn't see my shoes. Now I'm like, wow, that's cool. Yeah, those are some nice feet there. You know, you look down, you see your feet. But the same thing, it's light, it's exposing your feet. But how many know you don't, when you walk, you don't look at your feet, right? You look at where you're going. You look at your path. That's what it does. It exposes what's going on in your life, but it gives you hope for the future. It lights these pathways that's like, man, I want to experience what God has for me tomorrow, for today, for the next day. Then I want to bring others in the light. Man, when you're exposed to the goodness of God, you want to share it with everybody. You want to bring everybody in. Man, get your kids on the same path. See, our kids are having a great time learning about Jesus today in church. Their whole day was designed around the light, around God, around learning about Jesus. In our nursery classes, those little babies are hearing for the first time, some of them, about God, and about the light, and about Jesus. See, for some in this room, you weren't exposed to the light until you were like 25, 26, for some 50, 55, older. And you were exposed, and so you were exposed to the dark for a long time. Maybe some lights were triggered in your life and God impacted you, but for the majority of your time on this earth, you were around, you know, dark places and dark things, and then God illuminated your life and changed your eternity. But we have the opportunity to have these young lives, these young people that, man, we can turn on that light bright. Just life and love and God in their life. And, man, they don't know the darkness like you knew the darkness. They don't know the perversion like you knew the perversion. Because their life is filled with light and love and the things of God. See, the lamp is God's word. It is in front of our life. It is leading our path. It is guiding us. It shows us which way to go. It guides your path. Now, in Luke 15, it talks about lost things. In our worship set, we learned about God leaving the 99 and going after the one that was lost. And in Luke 15, it talks about a lost coin, a lost sheep, and a lost son being the prodigal son. But look in Luke 15 when it talks about the coin and what the importance is with the coin. In Luke 15, verse 8, in the parable of the lost coin, it says, "Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Won't she light a lamp and sweep the entire house and search carefully until she finds it?" But what did she do? She lit that lamp to expose the darkness. She lost something valuable, so she lit the lamp, she lit it, and she exposed all the dark places. And that's what light will do. It'll expose those things in our life. It'll expose things until we find it. We find our way. We find those lost things. Have you ever lost something? You lost a friendship. You lost a relationship. You lost a marriage. We have people in our church that have been divorced and God has restored them. Maybe you've lost a child. You've lost them spiritually. They're out doing their own thing. Have you ever lost money? Lost an investment? You lost a home? Yeah, people have lost things. Some people have lost their health. Look at what Jesus says to do when you lose something. He says you need to light a lamp. Just like that woman lit a lamp to find the coin. She lit the lamp and swept the whole house looking for the lost thing. See, the best time to read God's word is when you have lost your way. Sometimes when people are lost, people are hurting, people are down and out, people have lost something in their life, lost your health, man, you'll go to everything to find your peace. Talking with Alan and Janice broke her shoulder, and it's broken like three places, and it's messed up. But every word, they're saying, God's healed me. God is healing me. Man, we have an appointment with the doctor, but God's healed me. See, that's the faith that we walk in. That's the light that we're walking in. There may be a loss of that comfort and that health and that thing that you know, you use every day. But her hope is in Jesus. Her hope is not in, man, I hope they just get it all right and the pain goes away. Well, I know that's her hope, but that Jesus is her solution in the whole process of her healing. So the first thing is that the lamp unto my feet, and the second is a light to my path. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, you can write that down, follow along behind us, but this is talking about living in the light. And this is the message we heard from Jesus, and now declare to you, God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. So we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God, but we go on living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth. But if we are living in the light, in the Word, as God is in the light and God is the Word, then we have fellowship with each other. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. See, it helps us with that relationship with Jesus. It opens, it loses, it brings back, and it helps us with those lost things, but it lights our path. It is living in the light. John chapter 3, verse 20, 21. All who do evil hate the light and refuse to go near it for fear their sins will be exposed. But those who do what is right come to the light so others can see that they are doing what God wants. Have you ever known that, you know, people that don't follow God, they're pretty negative towards God? So there's some people that are kind of neutral and you can have discussions and kind of debate things. But those that are away from God, they're like, no, that's nonsense. But the Bible talks about that the Bible has not been exposed to them. When their heart is away from God, the Bible doesn't make sense. It just is, it's just not feasible. That's why we have scientists and people that are, you know, like talking about stupidity about how the world was created. It just doesn't make sense without the Word of God. Without a creator. Don't talk to me about, you know, how I just became. I'm not an accident. I just didn't happen. You know, we have Rebecca and she's pregnant, gonna have a baby in a couple months. And it's just like, that doesn't happen just by accident. There had to have been a creator for that, especially for those two people. That is like a miracle of God. And what is inside of her is a miracle. You know what I'm saying? To bring two people together like that is a miracle. Amen. And then to have that miracle give a miracle, it's just a miracle. But it's awesome. It's awesome to see God do that. It just doesn't happen by chance. and you can't create that. Only God can do that. There's a quote by Ari Torrey, "Sin will keep me from this book, but this book will keep me from sin." I like that. Sin will keep me from this book. Those that don't want anything to do with God, man, they talk bad about church, talk bad about the Bible. But this book will keep me from sin. See, that verse said that all who do evil stay away from the light. They stay away from the word. They stay away from things of godliness. See, when you're in sin, when you're running from God, the last thing you want to do is get into God's word. The last thing you want to do is go to church. What do people say when they talk about church? Oh, if I go in that church, I'm going to be, struck by lightning. You know that's never happened? Never. Lightning happens on the outside, not on the inside. See, I think that for some people when they're running, I know that when I'm running from God, I don't want the word of God in my life. You know, can I expose myself a little bit? Give you a little something, to chew on about when I run away from God. Now, I have an advantage because I had good parents, thank you, Mom and Dad, that raised me right, and I was raised in church, probably saved when I was 5 because I don't remember. I might not be saved. I don't know. I got saved so long ago, I might not be saved. That's how long I've known God was I got saved before my brain even knew that I was saved. I haven't known anything else. But I do know one thing. There are some things in my life that I do when I'm running from God. As a believer, as a Christian, we run from God. And I know one thing. When I listen to music that is not of God, there's always something in me that's like, why am I listening to that? And I know I'm the only person that goes through that. When I find myself listening to secular music, I'm usually running from God. That's just me. That's not for anyone else in this room. I'm exposing me, okay? That's me. I know that's not you. That's me. But when I find myself looking to other things to give me fulfillment in my life, and I'm not saying that I like songs. There are songs that I like. I'm telling you, in me, that's step one on a different path. Because I'm a man of God. I preach the word of God. I need to be fed with the things of the light. So in my life, man, I do things differently. Not just in the world, but a lot of people that are followers of God. I have to set myself apart. My wife and I make decisions in our life not to do things that I know people that follow Jesus, they do as part of their life. We don't do certain things. But I know in me, step one away is probably listening to some things I shouldn't. So if you get in my car and you hear me listen to something, you're like, Pastor Devin, you're on your way. Don't do that. No, you can do it to me. But I'm telling you, it is. It was the same way when I was a kid. It was just a trigger. Something I did. Things in my life that you know. See, it might be something different for you. You might find yourself at a different place and a different walk. And what fulfills that need in your life? And it might be something silly like listening to secular music or whatever. It might be watching the movie that you just like, no, I shouldn't be watching this. It might be, reading something or doing something. See, it's those small steps away from the light that get you caught up in the things of darkness. See, when we make a mistake, when you are in bondage, you need to read the word. Why? Because light takes care of the darkness. See, I brought up a little thing because a lot of people are in here like, I like listening to secular music. It's okay. Don't get me wrong. Don't turn off because I said that. I'm telling you, that was for me. That's a trigger for me. But you have your own triggers that lead you on that dark step. That might not be one. You can there. You take that for what it is, but there are things in our life that we need to expose because they're leading us down the wrong path. See, when you turn on the light switch, there's not an argument between light and dark. Light will win every time. There's not a fight in it. Light wins. There's not a struggle. Light wins. Turn on the light in dark places in your life. Expose the light. Expose the darkness to those things in your life that are dark. See, if you have a dark area in your life, the best thing you can do is to read the Word. And sometimes it's the last thing we want to do when we're in struggle. It is a lamp to my feet so I can see my next step. And my next step. And my next step. And then soon you're used to walking and you're used to those steps and you can look ahead. Make plans to see what's ahead. See, you have to remember God's Word is eternal. It's eternal. It's not just, you know, right for 2021. It's not just right for 3,000 years ago. It's eternal. There are things that we must do to have God's Word speak in every situation, in everything, to hear God's Word, to hear from God as you read it. See, we have to do some things. If you're not receiving from God's Word, if you're not receiving that light, there's some things you need to do. There's some things that you can do. Man, when God seems far away, first step, you need to enter into His presence. You need to get yourself in that place of worship. Get yourself into the presence of God. Psalms 104, it says, enter His gates with thanksgiving. Go into His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. Spend time praising Him. Don't stop praising Him until you're there. Don't stop praising Him until you're in His presence. Don't stop. Get in His presence. Second thing is prayer. You got to make those requests known. Write your prayers down. Write those things down and tell God your heart. Tell God what's on your heart. When you do, when you pray, man, you'll sense the Holy Spirit. You'll know it. You'll know His presence is near. You'll know that He's with you. See, do you realize something? Prayer doesn't change God's mind. You don't change God when you pray. Your mind changes. You get closer to the will of God and the purposes of God as you pray, but you don't change God's will when you pray. See, if you're on a boat, I heard this illustration this week, but when you're, you know, on a boat and you throw that line to shore and onto that dock and tie that rope and you pull yourself, how many know that you're not pulling the dock to you? You're not pulling, it is secure. It is stable. It is where it needs to be. And that's God. And when you throw your hope and connect it to God, man, you're not pulling God to you. Come into my life. Come into my darkness. No, He's saying, no. I'm with you, but you come on my way and my path, my truth. This is unchanging where I'm going. Do you get that? Some people want to pull God to them. And God, you're going to have to come into my world now. Let me show you how I work and how I talk. And it's like, no, God changes you. You come closer to Him. It's not going to go the other way. There's not two word of God. There's one word of God. Just because you become, now some of you guys are really cool, way cooler than I am, but it doesn't change God's Word. Just because somebody cooler comes on the scene or somebody louder, come on, more popular, they don't change just because their words are louder and more popular, and man, they got a lot of people following them, doesn't mean that just because it's louder that it's right. The third thing is God will give you a word. God will place something into your heart. Then, man, you need to tell somebody about it. When God gives you something, man, you need to, man, it might be for somebody's situation. God healed you. Man, that's a healing wasn't for you. It's for you to go and encourage somebody else. God took you out of a situation. Man, encourage somebody else. God exposed some dark. Man, go and help somebody out. Just give that word of encouragement. Give that love to somebody. But we need to get into our word. You need to have that daily devotion, daily plan, daily reading. If you need to hear about marriage, read a marriage story. Read about Abraham and Sarah and Isaac and Rebecca and Jacob and Rachel. Go and read about these stories. Boaz and Ruth. But you need to set aside some time to get around the light. See, he doesn't need to talk to you through a pastor or a podcast. He wants to talk to you directly. He wants to have a relationship with you. He's a good, good father. He's a friend that stands closer than a brother, but he wants to hear from you. You think, oh, no, God's all-knowing. He knows all my problems. He wants to hear it from you. He doesn't want to just hear from you in times of desperation, of you falling down. If I just survive this situation, I'll follow you for the rest of my days. But how about when you're on top and you're making plenty of money and your marriage is good and everything's good? Are you still going to God in the midst of your righteous behavior where you have no sin and everything is good? Let's bow our heads and let's pray this morning. I want to ask you, I know that there may be some here today, you don't know Jesus, and or maybe he's been calling you and calling you back. But I believe that there are people here and you have dark corners in your life. Like the Word of God said that we need to light that lamp into the dark corners of our life. And there might be some habits, there might be some secret stuff in our life, there might be some secret hurts that we need to expose to the light. And I want to pray for you this morning. And as we're just praying and as we're in this atmosphere of prayer, I want you to start to allow God into those dark places. Allow him in. Ask him, God, what is in my life that needs to be exposed this morning? The cool thing about the Holy Spirit is he will never lie to you or let you down. Every time I ask God, what is in my life? What is in those dark corners? He lets me know. And he will let you know this morning. So that's one. I believe that there are some exposing that God wants to do this morning. We never want to shy away from talking about sin because we all sin every day. We all go through it. And there is not a pretty sin. The enemy will want, oh, no, it's just a white lie. That's just something. No, man, that sin will lead to death every time. Doesn't matter how big or little in your life. So that's the first thing. I want to pray for those dark corners in our life, those dark things, maybe some unforgiveness, some things in our life that we need to get right this morning. The second thing I want to talk about is if you've never asked Jesus into your life, that's where everything starts. There cannot be forgiveness of sins without Jesus. Doesn't matter how good of a person you are, how generous of a person you are, without Jesus, there is no salvation. There is no heaven. There is no forgiveness of sin. And I want to ask this morning, as we're in an atmosphere of prayer, as our heads are bowed, if that's you this morning, if you've never asked Jesus in your life, you want to do that this morning. Just want you to raise your hand. Or maybe you're that lost son, lost daughter, and you've walked away from God. and you want to come back this morning, I don't want you to hesitate. We do this every week in our church, or most weeks in our church, and give people the opportunity to ask Jesus into their life or get right with God. And if that's you this morning, I don't want you to delay. Raise your hand. We thank you, God. If you don't know that heaven is your home, I don't want you to leave this place without knowing for sure. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Father, I pray right now for every situation, every dark corner. God, every heart that is hard towards you. God, for some, that it may be that they're running from the word, they're running from the lamp, they're running from the light, they're running from you. And they haven't been going to their word this summer. They haven't been spending time with you on a regular basis. God, there's no excuse. God, I believe that those lamps need to be bright because that light's coming from you. And right now, I want you to expose those things in our life because I believe that you are a just God and you will forgive us our sins when we confess them. We thank you, God. We praise you, God. I'm going to pray a prayer of dismissal this morning, and I want to open the altars. And if you need prayer this morning, we have people that want to pray with you. I want to pray with you. And I don't want you to go away. If you need somebody to come alongside, believe for a miracle in your healing, your health, please come to the altar. But we know that we want to respect your time, and those that need to go get your kids and get on with your day, we want to excuse you too. But if you need prayer, please stay behind. We'll pray with you. Father, we thank you for this week, God. We thank you for our lives being led by the lamp, led by the word. And it's important to talk about reading your word, talk about how we can be influence to go to the darkness, but God, that we can be influenced to go to the light, to go to your life as we're being led by the lamp. God, we thank you and we praise you. God, we love your word. We love your house. We love your people. Be with us as we go, God. You're a great God. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. We love you guys. If you need prayer, please come up. We have people that want to pray with you. Amen.